Nicole Bobek won her first U.S. Ladies Championship. Meanwhile, Todd Eldridge came back after a 3-year absence from the medal stand to win his 3rd national title. Today, we bring you the dance competition. 1993 champions Rene Rocca and Gorcha Sir couldn't compete last year due to injury. And the defending champions Elizabeth Punsalin and Jared Swallow look forward to renewing their rivalry.
Rene and Gorcha and Liz and I were tied going into the original dance, but we never got to compete against each other. Free dance.
A broken bone ended Rocca and Sur's chance to repeat as champions.
That was not the way we wanted our story to finish. We wanted to see what was beyond that.
Today, America's best ice dancers go head-to-head in the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships.
Civic Center in Providence, Rhode Island for our continuing coverage of the 1995 State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships. Hello again, everyone. I'm Julie Moran, and today we'll be bringing you the ice dancing final. It will be a head-to-head confrontation between 1993 national champions Rene Rocca and Gorcha Sir and the defending U.S. champions Elizabeth Punsalin and Jared Swallow. And only the winner will skate at the World Championships. But that's only where the dramatic story begins. For more, here's Jimmy Roberts.
Well, Julie, this is a story that is so complicated, so bizarre, and at times tragic, that it might seem more like soap opera fiction, but it's not. It's reality. The last year in the lives of these four skaters is proof that sometimes truth is stranger than fiction, and sometimes it's just harder to believe. It was a period of time with no emotional middle, only highs and lows. Back in 1990, Gorcha Sir had defected from Russia. In order to skate on the U.S. Olympic team, though, he would need to be a citizen. So the team tirelessly lobbied Congress to speed up the process, only to see it derailed on the eve of the 94 Nationals.
You never count on anything 100%, but it seemed to be moving in the direction that we wanted, and things seemed to be okay. And then the week before Nationals, it just all blew up.
Their Olympic dream was crushed. And when Rene broke her wrist in a freak collision during a practice a week later, gone too was their hope of even defending their national title. But as hopeless as things seemed for Rocca and Sir, they were just that bright for their old friends and training partners, Elizabeth Punsalin and Jared Swallow. 3 years before, Rene and Gorcha had choreographed the routine with which Liz and Jared won the 91 championship. Now in 94, with a stirring performance before a hometown crowd in Detroit, Liz and Jared would win a second title. Gorcha and Rene would stay home. Punsalin and Swallow would go to Lillehammer.
Put it all together and have a performance like we did this evening in front of your friends and family is definitely a dream come true.
Things could not have been much better. Less than a month later, they could not have been much worse. 8 days before Punsalin and Swallow were to march in the Olympic opening ceremony, Liz's father was fatally stabbed by her brother. Courageously, the two went to Lillehammer and dedicated their performance to her dad.
Felt like skating was a relief from everything that had been happening off the ice, and when we got back on the ice, it was calm, you know?
In the lives of four people, there was disappointment and tragedy, precious little joy. In the crucible of competition, their relationships soon changed.
I don't think that what happened on the ice make it more distant. I think what was happening off the ice kind of kept a little bit more cool air in between.
It was the citizenship issue. Gorcha and Rene had lobbied Congress before the 94 Nationals, but they were shocked to later find out that so too had Jared and Liz.
Well, frankly, we wrote letters of disapproval for the reasons that everyone should go through the system. of getting naturalization in the same manner. Everyone should be equal. There wasn't one individual who pushed it. There was quite a large contingent. And I'll be honest with you that we were part of that contingent.
To have a citizenship or naturalization rushed, I think, was the point of view we were coming from. And it hadn't been done for any athletes in the past. I mean, Yvonne Lendl or anyone. So we were just trying to use our rights as citizens and use the government, democracy, whatever, to our advantage.
And so with the issue of Gorsha's citizenship still unresolved, they will compete against each other start to finish at nationals for the first time since 93. But with all the frustrations they went through, why did Rocha and Sir come back?
We didn't want that to be the ending. That was not the way we wanted our story to finish. We wanted to see what was beyond that.
The national title is at stake, and America's only berth on the world team. But clearly for these four skaters, that's just the beginning.
So here are the standings after the original dance. Rocha and Sir are the leaders at this point. Puntsalan and Swallow are just behind in second. In the third position, Robinson and Breen.
Joining me now is Dick Button. And Dick, how will everything that's happened to these couples affect the competition?
Well, I don't think it'll have much impact at all. Those judges are sophisticated enough to evaluate the skating and the competition on the basis of what the skating is, not on who has written what letters to whom or who has been through a tough time emotionally. Now, that favors Rocha and Sir, who have never lost to Puntsalan and Swallow. And remember, change in ice dance competition occurs with the speed of a glacier. To be sure, things could be a little uncomfortable, a little icy backstage, but I think the best skaters will win.
Representing the Detroit Skating Club in Bloomfield Hills, Michigan, please welcome now Elizabeth Puntsalan and Jarrett Swallow.
Well, the head-to-head battle starts right here. Whoever wins the free dance portion of this competition will win the title.
Feel that this is almost a 20s, 30s, 40s, and 50s retrospective. The opening music, John Gray, it's Charleston by a Russian band. Second of their four pieces of music, Ojos Negros, a tango with a waltz feel. Style of ice dancing. Particularly older ice dances where four pieces of music were used to demonstrate different styles of ballroom dancing.
And this, of course, is the music Hubcats and Tail Lights from Breakfast at Tiffany's by Henry Mancini. Thank you.
Remember the rules of ice dancing? Extraordinarily restrictive. They list all the things you can't do. Even this lift, his arms can't go above his shoulders. And Duke Duke. Well, that's a very interesting dance in the sense that it's an old-fashioned one in the construction of four different types of music, demonstrating four different kinds of ballroom dancing. Each style of dancing being represented. Rather traditional, rather nice.
Yes, very they have strong. To be happy with that.
Well, they certainly are. Pleasant to watch. They work well with each other. They're obviously relating emotionally to each other. These steps, very musical, very tricky, very dangerous. Great fun to watch.
5.7. 5.7.
And the marks for technical merit range from 5.5 to 5.8.
5.7 and 5.7.
And those marks, while they're good, are certainly not marks that can prevent any other skater from pulling up over them, and I think that leaves the door completely open.
Those are Jared's parents there, anxiously looking on.
5.7, 5.7, 5.1.
And the marks for artistic impression from 5.7 to 5.9.
Now, those marks are considerably higher than the first set of marks, and that's because they created such a wonderful presentation on the ice, a very pleasant one. But it leaves plenty of room open should Roken Sir skate up a storm.
16-year-old Kate Robinson and 25-year-old Peter Green have only been skating together since May of 94. 8 months later, they find themselves having a chance to medal at these nationals. They are in third after the original dance.
Dark Eyes, from the movie track in which Nureyev played Valentino. She's 5'6", and it gives a very long-limbed look to their ice dancing. Their choreography is in a way gentle and consistent. It doesn't have wild leaps and bounds and changes. It is not a highly dramatic or theatrical number, emphasizing the lyrical quality of ice dancing.
You've seen Peter on ABC before. He skated for 7 years with Rachel Mayer, and they were second at the 92 championships.
Program. Very romantic, very elegant, very beautifully edged skating. I must found it to be very enjoyable. It wasn't as difficult. It wasn't as tricky. The steps weren't as complicated, but it was certainly very beautiful to watch and lovely. Isn't she the quintessential pre-Raphaelite heroine? Look at the looks that she exudes there.
She certainly is, and we'll be back with their marks right after this. Our next skaters, Amy Webster and Ron Crevette, are in fourth place coming into this final phase of the competition.
The music is Phantom of the Opera, but it's been reorchestrated to include the definite beat, a beat that can be danced to on a ballroom floor as required by the ice dancing rules.
The scores for Robinson and Breen for technical merit from 5-2 to 5-5, and for artistic impression from 5-3 to 5-6.
Lester and Cravette left their coaches, Barrett Brown and Tom Lisinski of Boston, to go and work with Linichuk and Karpinosov, the 1980 Russian Olympic dance champions. After 4 months, they returned to this style of dancing. They didn't feel that the authoritarian, restrictive school, Russian school, was for them. Neither was the style. And now we're seeing a program emphasizing grace and elegance.
Keep in mind, the free dance is worth 50% of the total score. An engaging, compelling number for Amy Webster and Ron Corbett. They both train in Boston. A lot of local support here in Providence, and it's easy to see why.
And their skating is particularly elegant. They have a very strong line, strong edges, sweeping edges. This lift, one of the few that is allowed by the rules, but very inventive and very dramatic. A clean performance, good masculine-feminine appeal in this couple. Very nice.
As you see, very good scores for technical merit from 5-3 to 5-6, and higher for artistic impression from 5-4 to 5-7. And those marks put them in second with only Rocca and Sir left to skate. That's next.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rene Rocca and Gorcia Sir.
Rene Rocca and Gorcia Sir said, "The most important thing for us is that we have a conclusion to our story. They have a chance to write their happy ending right here in Providence."
The music, Fever, Harlem Nocturne, and Red Blues. Jazz and a blues number inspired by choreographer Hermes Pan. A little bit of 50s movies, a little bit of Sid Charisse. Thank you.
Rocha told us this is a very emotional night for him. It's the first time his grandmother has seen him skate since his defection from Russia, and she is here in the audience.
These moves here, you can see, are very difficult. I mean, this is not an easy dance.
He did tell us he's been a little bit distracted. He says, every time I step on the ice, I'm looking for her. I'm looking for her in the stands. Well, she's watching, Gorsha.
In comparison to the previous dances they've done, there's a great more upper body movement. And look at that. Oh! That's really a tough dance, you know. It's a first-rate performance. I don't think there's any doubt that the quality of that dance is among the best that we'll see this evening.
And there's grandmother looking on. What a special moment for her.
A first-rate dance. Remember, they've been also in first place through both of the compulsory dances and the original dance. And with the quality of that dance, it seems likely they'll stay in first place now.
And we'll be back with their scores right after this.
For Rene Rocha and Gorsha Sir, a highly energetic program. Look at those expressions. They're having a ball out there. Good speed, good energy, difficult moves. A highly competent program from what could be the new U.S. champions.
And here are the marks for technical merit. Very high from 5.7 to 5.9.
And those marks are clearly higher than Punxsutawney and Swallow. So at this point, it puts them in first place. The artistic marks will conclude the picture.
And it's got to be difficult waiting. Only one team goes to the World Championships. And here are the marks for presentation, all 5.9s, 1.60. I think you've got your winners right there.
Absolutely. Well, it must make a very happy moment for them.
And, of course, Gorsha was the first non-American citizen to win a U.S. championship. He now has number two.
And those marks should make Rocha and Sir and their coaches extremely happy. Punxsutawney and Swallow, well, they were first rate. They should be very proud.
So here are the final standings. Rene Rocha and Gorsha Sir in the top spot. Elizabeth Punxsutawney and Jared Swallow will have to settle for second. Amy Webster and Ron Cravette in third. Robinson and Breen in fourth. Kuchicki and Small end up in fifth. And there are the rest of the top finishers. Let's go down to Jimmy Roberts, who's with our winners. Jimmy?
All right, Julie, thanks very much. For the second time in 3 years, you are national champions, Rene Rocha. And Gorsha Sir, you had said that you wanted to get back here so that there would be a conclusion to the story. Is this a conclusion or is it simply a middle chapter?
I think we're still in the middle chapter, actually. I'm very pleased with tonight, obviously, but, you know, from here on, it's who knows. We just wanted to get past tonight, and it turned out well for us.
At any point, did you think about all that you had been through in the last year?
No, not really. Since we made the decision to keep on going this season, there has been no turning back, no looking back, just forward, 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 just skate, 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 work as hard as we can. Just want to say it's been the hardest week of my life, probably.
Was there a sense of justice for you with this result?
Oh, I don't know. We never thought of it as a sense of justice because, you know, figure skating is sort of a fickle sport, so you just hope that you put out your best performance when the time counts, and after that, it's out of your control.
All right, well, this certainly was, or at least it had to have been, your best performance. Now let's go over to Leslie Visser, who's with Jared Swallow, and Elizabeth Punxsutawney.
The defending national champions will not be going on to the World Championships. Jared and Liz, how heartbreaking, how disappointing is this for you?
Well, it's a disappointment, but then again, we have to look at how well we skated all week. Every time we stepped on the ice, we skated like defending champions. And we're very happy with how we skated, and we leave the year on a very good note.
It was so entertaining to watch, but it's been such a tough year for you. How do you think you two will be able to handle this?
Well, from what we've been through this past year, this really isn't that difficult for us. I think
we'll be able to handle everything from here on out.
You're quite an inspiration. Well, you've had both good times and tough times with Renee and Gorsha. Do you have sort of mixed feelings about them going on to the world?
Well, I hope Renee and Gorsha skate as well as they did this week at Worlds so we can qualify another team for next year's World team. And if that happens, then we'll be one big happy family because we'll be hopefully going together.
Well, thank you both for your graciousness.
Thank you. So here in Rhode Island this week, this incredible story continues to write itself. For Elizabeth Punsilin and Jared Swallow, a disappointing result at the end of a difficult year. But with this strong performance, they leave Providence with their eyes on the future. And for Renee Rocha and Gorsha Sir, the newly crowned U.S. ice dancing champions, there is closure. And yet, the story continues. Well, another bizarre twist involving the U.S. Figure Skating Championships. The Associated Press reports today that 17-year-old Nicole Bobek, the 95 U.S. Ladies Champion, had been charged with home invasion. Thursday, Michael Friedman, Bobek's lawyer, said that the charges that the Ladies Champion burglarized a suburban Detroit home were dismissed last fall. Prosecutors say they will appeal the decision, saying she was given preferential treatment. Oakland County authorities in Detroit had charged Bobek with home invasion in November after a family in Bloomfield Hills claimed they saw her carrying cash out of the house. We'll continue to follow that.